来发言呢？我们现场有没有想要现场发言的？
In regard to your presentation, I was wondering that if there are any prospects your presentation, there are so many examples of science fiction, right? And I was wondering if there are any prospects to break the limit of the speculative fiction.To appropriate the aesthetics and experimental movie image and expanded cinema into the narrative cinema and art cinema instead of the, you know, like the 2001 that film by Kubrick. I mean, is there, as far as I am concerned, I focus on the sensory ethnography lab, and I think that's a kind of way that we can explore, and I don't know if you have any idea to expand that kind of aesthetics into another sphere. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very nice question. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the idea of this research was the beginning of a project which is still to be realized because I didn't get funding for it yet. But I wanted to basically bring together a number of audiovisual artists that I know about and the kind of practices that.Kind of fall between the cracks, like they're not cinema, it's not television, it's not even music video, but it's audiovisual. Like for example, I know people, they make moving images to show behind live performance of music, like whether it's rock music or electronic music, or other people who do video mapping or DJing, or other people who do kind of combine 3D printing with making kinds of music videos,using this kind of imaginative fabricated objects and so forth, and of course people making interesting uses of VR. So rather than seeing VR like separate to all these other practices, I sort of see this kind of immersive audiovisual continuum that we don't yet have a really language or a theory or thing to talk about, but it's all basically experimenting with, you know, creating kind of machines to generate new experiences and new kind of senses. And I sort of think that this should be taken in a very, very kind of open way that crosses multiple practices and opens up maybe some of the problematic aspects of VR in terms of this idea of these bubbles into something much more kind of creative and unexpected and also engage, you know, with pressing problems of the world. Even if I didn't quote Marx, you know, I still have that in my mind. Thank you. Thank
you.没有的话，那我还是按照这个 slide 这个顺序来念。有一个问题是提给吕秀宇老师的，这个问题是从电子书到手机报，再到今日头条和公众号，曾经主导的媒体场域的人文学者、作家和记者，被工程师和程序员夺权的恐慌，似乎正在变成现实。您是否有设想过什么行动主义的方法？来反击或制衡这种趋势。
我觉得行动主义的方法固然很重要，但是我不是特别的信任，只是以无政府主义，或者是 NGO 组织，或者是仅仅依靠这些方式，就能够改变。我觉得。在今天的这个历史条件下，可能更需要去讨论国家本身。就这个 今天的这个国家到底该扮演什么样的角色，我觉得这个可能是今天更重要的一个问题。至于说到这个媒介本身的转换，我觉得无论媒介技术如何转换，有一个功能是不会变化的，那就是媒介是为这个社会国家社群提供意识形态再生产的这个功能，它是不会变的。只要一个社群或者是一个国家，只要一个社群是需要存在的，或者是以主权形式的国家的主权形态还没有消失，那么一个社会主流的意识形态的再生产过程就是必须的，就是它是一个硬性的存在，所以问题不在于说回避这样的硬性存在，而是去考察技术与这个硬性的这个规定之间它的关系是如何产生的。我觉得这个可能是更重要的。比如说我们今天目睹了新媒体时代的兴起，可是它并不是从天而降的。今天新媒体时代在很大程度上是传统媒体失败所诞生出来的，因为在二十世纪我们已经目睹了全球的媒体垄断化的过程，这个垄断化的过程对民主的扼杀也是所有的批判所这个目睹和这个见证的。所以在这个意义上说，媒体平台的再垄断化的过程并不是创造了新的东西，只是一个博弈或者是一个斗争的方式的一个转换。所以在任何的时代，不管是我们从传统的这个时代到这个现代到今天新媒体时代，民众的话语权的问题，精英国家和民众的这个话语权的问题，其实都是结构性的存在，只是说在新媒体的时代这个格局在产生了一些变化，但是这些变化本身它的背后的那个结构性的要素，我觉得是今天需要重新去理解。所以我不是一个特别悲观主义者，在这个意义上说不是说只是但是不是说不赞成行动，我是不赞成那种只是悲观主义意义上的那种个人英雄主义式的那种意义上，而是说我觉得对人类的本身的这个信任，我觉得这个可能是更重要。这个信任是说我们有没有这个，就是在新媒体技术逼近地平线的时候，我们有没有可能在一个新的权力博弈的过程中，这个权力的博弈不仅仅是个人之间或者是个人主义的，或者是而是说在一个新的政治格局的过程中推动这个世界往和平发展的过程，而不是想毁灭的过程中去发展，对这个能否采取一个基本的信任。当然这个基本的信任的这个基石怎么去寻找，觉得这个是我们面对的当然是我们面对的任务，而这个任务不仅仅是媒体的、艺术的、政治的，可能是它是一个共同性的一个基石。问题是说这个基石我怎么去描述。
好，谢谢。下一个问题是问李可以先生。有问题说英铁河野先生本来也是科的，那在这个时代无政府主义的刊物应该如何被创造出来，也就是说在处处新媒体的情况下怎么样创造一个无政府主义的刊物。
Excuse me, what was the point? do you want to publish?
这个问题他可能是问就是说在这样一个新媒体的时代 如何创造出一份无政府主义的刊物。
啊，对。There is, there are many anarchist media on the internet. I can let you know. Maybe in an invisible way.
Exists. That's the mic. 是关于李安电影的。其实这里面有关，我不知道是有没有对话关系，就是同一个人发问的。他说：“请问 Michael， 你怎么看待李安电影在120帧技术上的努力？”这种并非致力于效果和奇观，而是希望用新技术还原人的内在情绪、心理的努力，试图让观众在沉浸式状态里去理解人性、去共情、去辨认拟真，就是这个 simulacre 和这个真实 reality 之间的区别，会不会是新技术更有希望的发展方向？这个明白啊？另外一位朋友他说我对120帧能带来更好的移情效果表示怀疑，技术上讲更高的帧率改善的是快速移动画面的流畅性，最受益的应该是打斗追逐画面，但对 VR AR 120帧等技术手段作用的推崇，我个人认为是夸大的，是否反映了在以硬件设备提供商为代表的资本的裹挟下，人文研究中技术至上论的流行。还有一个回应啊，我都把它读出来，正好让这个 Michael 他也可以综合来考量一下。他说，我觉得至少在李安这里并不是技术至上论，正因为商业裹挟的背景，这个在夹缝里的努力更是难得，当然也很有难度，甚至可能失败，但关于技术与奇观和人性的问题是否也是新媒体艺术创造的困境？我们需要何种沉浸呢？是沉默的一个对话的在于效果。
OK， 所以 a lot of things in there. I think behind this question, there's some big media theory questions, like for example, around technological determinism, like will the new technology or can new technology provide certain answers to aesthetic needs or even social or ethical needs, etc. Also, ideas about perceptual realism, and sometimes being more realistic is not necessarily an advantage, because actually realism is like a code, and it's a code that we learn through different forms. So there's a code of realism in the novel, there's a code of realism in painting, there's a code of realism in cinema, which is actually what the kind of training ground of the 20th century. So if things with digital forms become too realistic, then sometimes they don't seem very real, actually they seem quite disturbing. So we have this whole uncanny valley phenomenon and so forth. So I'm not sure, I'm always skeptical about any claim about some new technology or some new advance allowing for, in itself to generate just new experience or to solve this kind of, some particular problem. But I actually think that also there's another problem, which is, I think one of the ways where people are trying to see these immersive technologies as having a political function is this idea of them being this kind of empathy machines. So the idea that you can this Artman VR called We Wait, where you basically take the point of a refugee on the Mediterranean and you experience the world supposedly from that, you know, perspective, and it should generate this kind of empathy. I'm a little bit skeptical and dubious about that, and I'm not sure that this is actually the best kind of political or social uses of these technologies. I think they're more interesting in terms of allowing a kind of a fluidity of points of view and modes of perception that enables you to kind of maybe rather than empathize with, you know, with a sort of with the other, you know, adopt multiple other perspectives and maybe call your own perspective in question. I think that's a more interesting effect. So I'm not sure of the specific Angley project, but I think any of these projects can have interesting kind of potentials, but I think in the end it's really like anything else, like with cinema or anything or anything else, with music or whatever it is, it comes down to having having really good ideas that actually connect up the technology or the device or whatever technological advancement it is with some way of kind of, you know, opening up to the world and to people in a new and exciting way. So that would be my answer.
下面是一个给于老师的一个题目，他说：“个人提供的私人数据或内容，在网络上到底有无私有权，是一个关键的问题。否则呢，无法将马克思主义对私有制的批判，运用到对数字资本主义或者数据平台的批判。”这个问题你怎么看？
我觉得这个也是一个悖论，就是一方面，我觉得今天刚才大家也提到，今天后来的发展也一直有两条路线的斗争，一条就是，就是网络无政府主义的这个思潮，这个思潮这个共享共治，然后是所有的版权是这个所谓的copy left 运动的代表。那么在这一块这块非常重要的网络的这个力量的这个影响下，那么所有的就是私有财产权是要被破除的。但是当然我们也知道，在今天的现实世界里，私有财产权是保护的。那现在的问题是说，如果我们把现实世界中的这个私有财产权的概念搬到网上，你就会发现今天的这个数据作为私有财产，即便是在传统的私有财产权的这个概念下，也是很难界定的。是因为你创作的数据实际上是被数据公司拿掉的，你是没有主宰权的。比如说，你能不能把你的数据在你死了之后能够作为财产遗交给你的子孙后代呢？别人有没有这个继承权？那么继承权是用来干什么呢？所以这些问题其实在今天的这个法学界是还没有找到一个比较能够符合这个私有财产权的方式来处置这些问题。所以在国家层面上也会有不同的表现，比如说在中国，因为还处在鼓励新媒体技术发展的过程中，所以我们在这个方面的立法是不严格的，或者说我们现在正在面对这些问题。当问题出来之后，我们再来面对。比如说在欧盟，它已经有比较严格的限定，从私有财产权的保护来讲来限定。但它也可能会产生另外一个悖论，就是过于在网络上对私有财产权的界定之后，也会导致新媒体技术在发展层面上的制约。因为新媒体技术的发展本来是在破除私有财产的这个前提下来形成，所以你看到这里面有非常多的这个悖论，这也是我们这个时代悖论的一个体现。我们怎么去理解作为这个数据的这个存在，它是应该作为一个受到法律保护的个人资源，还是它应该成为一个受到法律保护的公司的这个利润的来源，还是在今天中国比较敏感的问题，就是这些私人公司他们掌握着，比如说像微信，他们掌握着是有8亿中国人的数据，那么在这意义上说，它会和 主权国家之间产生冲突。比如说这么多人的个人数据是在一个私人公司里面，它和一个国家的国家安全和主权之间的这个冲突，这些都是之前所没有发生过的。所以这些新的现象需要的是一个需要的是一个面对，就是说但是确实怎么去处置这些问题我们也在这个观察各个学科，比如说观察法学他们在怎么去处理这个问题我们会也许下个学期我们会在我们的传播学院做一个 workshop， 是关于就是互联网时代的这个法律这个和隐私权的这些问题那这些问题可能也是世界范围内大家在既有的人文社会科学所盲目的这些地方怎么样来面对这些挑战，我觉得这个可能是大家需要去共同思考的。
好，那时间正好到了12。
那最后一个问题，这个问题有没有？
Thank you all for your fascinating presentations. My question is directed to Professor Kazuya. So now that 100 years after, now that we're living in the digital century, and I think you've already mentioned that there are existing anarchist movements in the internet world as well. So can you share us or can you talk more about current trans-Asian or pan-Asian anarchist movements, particularly those working in the cyberspace, and what kinds of things are they doing right now? In your presentation, you mentioned that primarily before, the form of solidarity and collaboration among these anarchists is through translation, co-publishing, and sometimes they help each other bomb a warehouse or something. So yeah, so in the digital world, what are the forms of collaboration across Asia? Thank you.
Okay. I think that there are many experiments and practices has been going on still now for tomorrow, but I'd like for now to introduce you something concrete, but I like to try to a little bit more theoretical point of view. The new media theory, especially a Western German one in 70s to 80s, namely Hans Magnus Enzensberger had found the idea of Bertolt Brecht before the war, who said radio receivers can be transformed into transmitters. We can use media technology in the other way, inversely. So we can try various idea of reuse or misuse or detournement in a situationist world. That's the point I want to share all of you. Does it make sense?
Thank you. 那因为时间关系，我们今天上午的 panel 就到此为止。感谢三位嘉宾的精彩发言和提问。